hard part. You don't eliminate hate with hate. With hate. This is the Scary Guy Podcast.
Are you going to do a proper introduction or not? Would you want me to do this?
That is proper as it gets for me. I mean, you can go ahead. Listen, you can go ahead and do that. The problem is, I'm going to tell you, Gary, the problem is with Michael McCormick Williams. No, I got to say that. Rock on.
Yeah, rock on.
He's a good friend of mine, and I love him dearly, and I only know him as Michael McCormick. And I've been to his university and did some work there. And he's been over here and hung out with Catherine and I on many occasions. And so it's hard for me to introduce somebody that is a very dear friend to me. So why don't you introduce him?
Okay. Well, I think we've established now that we are talking to Michael McCormick Williams. So that's the first 10 minutes of our podcast down now, yeah?
Yeah,
and we've established that three names is actually okay. Otherwise, we'd be forever calling you The Scary. Okay.
Excuse me.
So three names is fine. How come you can do three names, but everybody else you pare them down to two?
Well, I don't have any name.
Oh, you just.
Well, I think the funny thing is that Scary's never called me a proper name before. You know.
That's true. I've never called you nothing civil.
Nothing civil. So that was the shocking bit. I'm happy that you can remember two names. Okay.
Anyway, Michael McCormick Williams. Go ahead, Gary.
So Michael is a senior lecturer in communication at the Fachhochschule Vorarlberg. It's the University of Applied Sciences in Dornbirn, Austria. Nice to meet you, Michael.
Nice to meet you too, Gary. And Scary.
So as a lecturer in communication, is that what drew you to Scary? The use of words as communication?
Well, as I said before, I mean, he did come, you guys both came to the university. And I'm like, hey, I really have to take advantage of this. This is so unique. And so I grabbed my two little girls, and Kate and Elena, and I took them to see Scary. And we have all been forever changed. I think after that, then we lost touch. I think Scary, we've known each other, what, over 10 years.
Yeah.
But we lost touch, and then we got, when his brother Tim passed, then I sent my condolences, and then we got in touch again. And then we just started, you know, staying in touch.
Yeah, I invited you over.
Yeah, yeah. And I've been over many times because I have the tattoos to prove it. So
you got tattooed.
You've been branded.
But you also went through some training, which was really important too, I think.
Yeah, yeah. The one-on-one training was...
Before you get to the training, before we delve straight back into the training, I just want to take you back to the first time that you came across Scary. So did you see the film on TV? Did you see something on the news? Or did you just see the advert?
I just got an email and said The Scary Guy, and I'm like, I have nothing to lose. I saw him. But what I took away from it was it just really resonated.
Which bit?
I think that just as teaching communication for me, it's basically a sociological theory of structure and agency, you know. And what Scary brought to the whole thing was basically taking those two things and making them coherent to an everyday lay person. But what really struck me. Was that, I mean, there were just some seminal truths that were coming out and how to treat people and how to take in information and these type of things. Yeah. That it just resonated with me so much, you know, that I just, I took that into consideration in my teaching and also trying to deal with, my kids and people.
So was there something within your background, having said that you grew up in the United States, you moved to Austria, you've been around and you've lived in different places and mm-hmm. and integrated in different types of communities and learned obviously different languages. So have you mm-hmm. found that communication and the way people behave is different in different places?
Yeah, to a certain extent. I mean, it's after moving around so much, you get to read people quite quickly in different cultures, because you don't have, let's say you're in a culture that you don't know the language. So then you have to go by other cues and other cues that, you know, body language and, tone of voice and this type of stuff. So people do communicate differently. I think the language does have a lot to do with it. It does form your thinking. And that's a key component of what, Scary is doing, is that this really does make inroads into your thinking, and words, as I said, words are energy, and mm-hmm. they really do have an impact. And so, and also this learned behavior. So you really have to unlearn that. And that's what really resonated with me, because I'm in education, and obviously I've learned some, bad habits too. And so my students, and then so we have to meet somewhere to make this a workable situation. We have to meet somewhere in the middle and be have a symbiotic relationship.
So can you remember that after seeing Scary for the first time, then your first time back in your classroom, in your lecture theater, can you remember the first thing that you either deliberately incorporated back into your teaching? Or was there something you thought, do you know what? I must have inherited that from Scary, absorbed it, and it's come out naturally?
Well, I mean, maybe it just gave me license to be more of me, since we're both from the States.
That's good.
So I think we're both from the States, so I think we do have this genetic disposition to be, as they say, out there. And it just gave me the license to do it, because it was effective, in the way Scary goes about his, gigs that he does, or his performances, or whatever, however you want, edutainment that he does. It does has an effect, it does pay off. And I was like, okay, fine. I think I can be more effective that way. Mm-hmm. Instead of having these preconceived ideas of what education should be and things like that, I rather, shake up the students a bit. And then it does shock the students, some of them, but they usually come around after a semester, because they know it's not mean-spirited. It's just I have a very limited amount of time with them, and I want them to do the best they can. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes to some of them, it's shock therapy.
Yeah, yeah.
and to others, it's like, yeah. It's all in contrast. I mean, the same with Scary. It's all within this context. You have this certain context, and he's bringing something left of center, and it kind of awakens something in people.
Yeah.
Did you say left of center?
Okay, right of center. Would you rather have that? Or
I don't want to know what left of center means. I never saw myself in the middle.
I thought we were not going to get political here, but fine.
I never saw myself in the middle of anything except for trouble.
Yeah, yeah. Well, left of center. I mean, you came at it as in a different
off center.
Off center, yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Weird.
Not going to go there.
A lot of people label me weird, though. That's okay.
Yeah, but that's a badge of honor.
Yeah, to me, if I don't get at least one weirdo thing out of it,
then I get that too. But again, it's the end effect. If it's just weird to be weird, that's self defeating. But it's weird to get you somewhere, and that's the payoff.
Could be. It works.
Question for you, Scary, for our listeners.
Yeah.
That are discovering you over these podcasts and haven't come across you before. So you're going around the world and you're giving your presentation. And of course it's in English, because that's the only language that you speak.
Yeah.
And I've seen it, so I know that it still works across the world in English. Just for the listeners that are listening in these various countries, have you found any differences between the audiences that you've been to?
Yeah, I found the differences, the biggest differences I discovered were in universities and on the East Coast in America, believe it or not. that sounds weird. No, but that was the truth. That was the truth. When I was in a New Jersey, College of New Jersey, giving a presentation to a lot of 20-year-olds, college students, and I had them stand up in the middle of my show and start screaming obscenities right in the middle of the show, right at me. And that was the only time that's ever really happened, is in America, in a higher education. All the other places I go, in Germany and Austria and France and Belgium and Sweden and all the other places, I've never, ever had a response like that, ever. It was only in America and higher education that I've gotten really, really severe negative feedback during my show. But they were all done in English, and all the other countries seem to be fairly, I don't know if they're agreeing with everything I'm saying, because they don't stand up and voice their opinion like they did in America. But I can tell you right now, they listen. They listen to everything we say. So that's a difference, I think. I don't know. I never had any negative feedback in Austria when I was there.
Well, I think it's what people bring to the whole event. You know, if they have a certain agenda, or they're stuck in a certain mindset, or, you know, learned behavior, which you're trying to shake them out of.
Right.
And that doesn't, you know, I guess in that instance in that New Jersey university, they weren't willing to sign up to that, which is okay, then why are you showing up?
Probably to protest.
Oh, okay, great.
Yeah, I mean, they probably had it already in their minds that they were going to be negative about something, so let's go to this guy because he's going to be different anyway, and he can't. I've had it even said to my face in America that, well, a major media corporation had said it, that I shouldn't be involved in teaching students in schools. That was blatantly spoken out loud by them in a news interview. Yeah, that I should not be in front of students ever in classrooms teaching them anything. So I suppose maybe if anybody's going to be negative, they're going to go and be negative and find a target, and that's exactly what they do. But I don't know that any other country is immune from that. I just don't think maybe they have the nerve to speak up, or they don't speak English as well to be able to speak their dissent out loud. I don't know. I didn't get any of that in any of the other countries. I only got it in America. I got a little bit in the UK, but not a lot. The UK is pretty open to listening to what I have to say.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because listening is a key element to communication. I'm assuming that's a key element that you teach to listen.
Yeah. I have a discussion course in the second semester, and it's moderating, you know, decision-making discussions. And basically, it revolves solely around listening. Mm-hmm. It's not, you know, getting your point out, or, you know, who's the alpha male, and who's, you know, no, it's definitely group dynamics, but it's about listening. Because if you don't have that element, what's the point?
Mm-hmm. Well, what is it, Michael? Why is it so difficult? Because you're an expert in this field. Why is it so difficult for some people to listen? And they just want to talk, and they want to get, maybe it's, they, I don't know, maybe you know, that they just haven't been heard, or what's the problem with society today? And I'm not saying everybody's got it, but I notice more and more everywhere I hear people speak in news and social media, everybody's so quick to speak before they even know what they're talking about. And so what is it, in your opinion, do you think, where people have such a difficult time listening? And let's say it's a difference of opinion. People have different viewpoints, like you pointed out. But if you have a different viewpoint, and you know I have a different viewpoint, and you have a different viewpoint, and I know you do, the natural tendency is to not even hear the differences. So why is it that we're like that today, do you think?
Because I think we're living in this, to use a German word, Zeitgeist. We're living in this time of, you know, broadcasting. everybody's broadcasting. Everybody has a YouTube channel. Everybody has, you know, everybody is profiling themselves on Instagram. Everybody's doing, and I see that. I mean, I do it to a certain extent too. I have my own little corporate identity through different media platforms. And I see it with my kids. It's more about broadcasting than entering in a conversation. Right. And that's the problem. And because, oh, I have a point to prove. And obviously, I mean, everybody knows this. I mean, when you're in a heated discussion, you're not listening to the person. You're thinking of what point am I going to get so I can cut them off at the knees. You know, you're not really listening. So you really have to catch yourself. And I do that. I mean, sometimes I'm in a heated discussion and I really just have to catch myself from lining up my next volley to really listen to that person and listen. Right. I mean, really, and that, if you don't come back with a quick, you know, retort, then I guess, you know, majority of societies thinks that's weakness. Right. You know, and it's now, I mean, we've lost the art of civil discourse. I think we've discussed this before. We have lost that art of entering in to civil discourse with people who disagree with us.
Yeah, you know, we're because, past it now, aren't we?
Yeah, well, I mean, we've lost the narrative on this one. We've lost the thread. Of because this is how we see each other as enemies,
mm-hmm.
you know, and not like, you know, and you would think with all the scientific discoveries, especially with, you know, with the space exploration and stuff like that, hey, we're humans on the planet. We're not different nationality. We're humans on the planet.
Yeah,
you know,
we have more in common than we've got on the planet than we do that's different.
And it's almost
that's right.
It's almost the smaller the planet gets because of the communication. I mean, look what we're doing now with Zoom links, with Skype links, with internet, with FaceTime, with everything else. It's almost because we can communicate with all these different people. People don't have any time. You would have thought everybody would see that we're all the same and not that we're all different. But it's almost like the world is full of sound bites. Everybody wants to give a sound bite and nobody then wants to listen. But I've discovered through listening to podcasts, you're spending time listening because you can't talk back to the podcast. So, okay, you do gravitate to podcasts that suit your needs maybe. But then if there's something that you think, I can learn that, but I'm doing it in a safe environment because no one can see me listening to this. I can disagree with this in private or I can have some kind of discourse in my own brain with this, then come to a resolution and then go and talk to somebody else about it. Whereas normally a conversation is if you're in a group of people and you're the person that doesn't disagree. So your group of 10, you're the one that doesn't agree with the other 9. It's very difficult sometimes to speak up.
Yeah. Well, it's pressure.
And there's
there,
things
that
happen all the time around the world. You know, when we look at it, we boil that down to when we're doing the schools and talk about bullying. And it's always about the bystander. But it is very difficult for a bystander to make any difference at that point. It's only when a group of bystanders get together as a group that I feel that then they can make a difference.
Can I say something before you add to that? Because I think it's a great topic that we're talking about because I think it's impacting the way people get along with each other today in the world instantly. It's an instant society we live in. But speaking of instantly, I heard from a young lady, Gary, I don't know if you know this, and Michael, from France, who's a friend of yours,
Lorraine,
who listened to the whole podcast. And I went, that is really cool. She listened to the whole entire podcast in France and then contacted me and sent me a message on Instagram. So it's that worked really well. And then when Gary came to me in the beginning of this whole process, hey, let's do a podcast show. I wasn't all that excited about it. I thought, nah, I don't know, you know, but it is the hot thing to do. Everybody that's anybody has a podcast show and everybody's putting them out there.
Yeah.
So I just thought, it doesn't sound like it's going to be much fun. And it's turning out to be really, really cool. I think it's going to be one of the more important things that we do in our lifetimes. And that's just because it is allowing people to listen. Now, I interrupted your train of thought. So Gary asked, do you remember what you were talking about?
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to hang on to what Gary was saying about time, that's the positive part of the podcast, is that you have to listen, or you can scream at the podcast, but that's not going to do much of anything, but you have to listen. And these are fundamental philosophical questions. Like Heidegger in was it Being in Time or Time in Being? I mean, this huge philosophical tome that he wrote, he was talking about time, and that's the one thing that really defines us. And what we've done with all our technology is basically, we haven't gained time. We haven't used it to our advantage. We've just filled our time with this, I don't say idiotic, but I mean, with this superficial, activities, mm-hmm. And not using, but I mean, your point of connecting with my friend, through, Instagram and stuff like that. And it's like, yeah, this is what we should be doing. I mean, I tell that, I don't get to see my kids, so much. And so I use, social media as a way and WhatsApp and all that as a tool to keep in touch. Of course you can use anything as a weapon or anything, you can abuse anything. I mean, my gosh, we've had this, debate since, the beginning of time.
Right.
It's like, oh, fire. You had fire. Oh, that's going to ruin everything now.
That blasted wheel.
Yeah, the wheel.
Yeah, the wheel. I mean,
oh my God.
What were they thinking?
No, we can make a fire on a cart and roll it over to their house.
Yeah.
That's right. The good old days of carrying it in your hand. So yeah, the time element is really important. But the other thing, I think, getting back to what Scary has taught me is, seeing people, separating this, people into, two images of a behavior and the person. And that that takes training. That's learned behavior. By doing that, then you kind of have this, then it gives you a little bit of, cuts out a bit of space.
Yeah,
for you to time for you to see that person not as an enemy, not as whatever adversarial, but to see them, and even if you do disagree with them, and you see them as a behavior, they're learned behaviors, and obviously as a person, and
a lot of learned behavior is adversarial.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Well, I mean, I'm talking about the UK. I mean, the great G.K. Chesterton, who was a mountain of a man, literally and figuratively, in literature in the UK. He wrote, the Bible tells us to love our neighbors and also love our enemies, probably because generally they are the same people. But I mean, this is the paradox.
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely.
With your behavior and seeing the image of behavior in person, this kind of puts it in a clearer focus.
Well, yeah, and what it's done for me personally is it allowed me to slow down and listen.
Uh-huh.
See, I wasn't a very good listener for many years. I was more of a talker and more of somebody that wanted to get my message. If I could get my message into you, then you would get better and be fixed. And then I would feel better and I would be fixed. See? So that's mm-hmm. how I live my life. Now, did I know that during that time period? No, I didn't see it that way. I just said, as long as you spoke words that I could agree with, then you were my friend. But whenever you spoke words that I disagree with, you were my enemy. And that's how I saw it. And that's how I think a lot of people see it today. Everybody sees it as a good versus evil, enemy versus ally relationships. And it all has to do with the fact that none of us, like you said, I don't think are very good at really listening. And what the separating people into two different pieces, and I do that every day, I have to remind myself, because that just happened to me on Twitter. I told you what my incident was on Twitter, where somebody labeled me a weird one. And my first gut feeling when I read that, this is words I read. He didn't even hear him speak them. you know, I just read him and I went, you could just feel the hair on the back of my neck because he was calling me a name, you know, and I could just feel my energy come up like this. I went, and I was, okay, what can I do to get the key in my words, you know? And I think, wait a minute, that goes against what I teach. And I go, I can't do it. You know, I want to do it. I want to get back into the old fist fighting routine and hammer it out and call the guy some names back. But I don't. I just decided to just leave it alone and go back to my teaching, which was everything that he creates is a reflection of who he is. And none of it is about me, even though he said my name in the sentence. Mm-hmm. And so I just believe that so wholeheartedly that the energy that person was creating was his energy. So it's a reflection of him. It's not mine. But the natural instinct on social media was to go to the fight, go to the battle, argue, fist fight, whatever it takes, you know, to be that, like you said, the alpha male. I was an alpha male. I want to be the alpha male. I can't let that guy beat me up. You know, that's how it felt.
Well, so it's this binary, this false binary relationship. It's either, you know, on or off. It's either good or evil. And that's not the true reality. No. And what you're teaching is breaking that binary, because that's not true. You're not all good or all evil. You know, we're not all, you know, we're not one way or the other. And even in a belief system, okay, like you have Christianity and you have this, good and evil. But yeah. If you look at, I mean, if you start drilling into the characteristics of the devil, then, you know, or Satan, okay, evil, yeah, but he's the angel of light and highly intelligent and things like this. So it's not, is that evil? You know, I mean, it starts falling apart. Once you start looking at, you know, things more closely, the binary falls apart. But the other thing is, you know, when it comes to this whole broadcast mentality that we have, you know, reason why is because we're rewarded. We are rewarded for that. Just think of, I mean, I have one of my, I think, was it, you know, one of my sons, Jonathan, he didn't speak, you know, for a long time. And then, okay, of course, then, you know, society, parents, you know, doctors, that's a red flag. What's wrong with him? Is he deaf? What, you know, no. You know, so you know, is speaking, you know, and broadcasting yourself, and you know, especially in Western society, is rewarded. It's constantly rewarded, and it's not getting us where we need to go.
Well, you know how we're rewarded today, don't you?
How?
By the number of likes. Mm.
Oh yeah, yeah,
well, this is, and we're programmed. Check this out, dude. This is unbelievable. Talk about brainwashing. They've got us to believe. I sincerely believe, because I see people post it all the time. Hey, you guys, come and like my this, like my that, like me, like this. And the number of likes. There's this new platform called TikTok. I'm sure you've heard of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's all they're about is getting people to like their pages. That's it. That you are ranked and rated as a human being by the number of people that have hit the like button. That's it.
Yeah. And, but it's also a business model. If you want to, you know, make money at this and get, crazy. You know, get, you know, it's a marketing model of, you know, how many likes you had, then you can have this advertisement or you get more money for the advertisement that's on your channel.
So I'm a failure, is what you're trying to tell me.
Oh yeah, well, I didn't want to say it that way, but I mean,
yes, I don't have on one platform. I don't have that many. I only have 2,600 likes. You know,
I don't think this is the platform to discuss this.
And I think on another platform, yeah. I have.
If you listen to this, don't like us. We don't want any likes. No follows, no views, please. Because
89,000 likes later, I'm like really successful, and I'm going, will I be able to sell a T-shirt now? Yeah. You know, that's what I think in my mind. Who's going to buy my stuff?
If no one watches this then or listens to this, then we've got a very successful product, because we know that no. Years and years ago, I posted something about what Scary was doing. I don't know what country we were in. And it was a clip of one of the TV news done an interview. You know, it was a soundbite from Scary, but it was about what was going on, about behavior and everything else. And I think, and I don't know what social media platform it went out on, but it must have had 20, 30 views, maybe. I don't remember. Underneath that, someone else had posted, came up on my timeline, what color pants are you wearing today? Which had got 1 million views. So yeah. It's like, okay.
1 million views.
Okay. Okay. Just a suggestion. You know, when you do post this as a podcast, put a kitten in the visual, yeah, yeah. Please.
Exactly.
A kitten.
Yeah. Wearing wearing green pants. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, yeah, please. Because I think then we'll get the hits.
Or those little hearts on your cheeks.
Oh, yeah.
It's so sad.
It's bad, isn't it?
Just terrible.
Let me take this back to I'll edit all this round later on. I want to go back to
good luck on the post on
Oh, don't worry about it.
Don't fix forever. This is too cool.
This is good. There's two types. There'll be an editor's director's cut and obviously just the
I'll version. Give you a like on this. Don't worry about it.
It'll be fine.
Yeah. I don't trust that man.
It's the trailer. I want to go back to the bit you talked about time. With the with the COVID-19 and the fact that almost everywhere around the world they've had to adjust to this and be locked down, a lot of families, for a lot of them, it's the first time they've ever spent that much time in each other's company. Do you think, going back to the time issue, that in a way that this period of time in the world could actually benefit people? Are there people taking advantage of this and actually recalculating their life?
Oh, yeah. I think you can, you know, unless it's a dire situation that you lose your job from this, you start to reprioritize, you know, things. I mean, I don't live with my kids, I really cherish the time I have with them, and I try to make as much time as I can, whether it's, you know, via cyberly or face to face. You know, it's just like, hey, you have time? Oh, let's go for a quick coffee then. Mm-hmm. You know, so yeah, and you just can't get that back. You know, really, it's how people prioritize it. Why do you have kids then? I mean, you know, if you're not going to enjoy their company,
talking to the converted, you know? But it's something that seems to be it's that busy. You know, like you mentioned time, so it's the fact that everyone wishes their time away, whether it be on their schedule, their calendar, everything is pre-programmed. So they're always looking forward to the next thing, the next thing, the next thing, the next thing.
Yeah, yeah, but there is a sweet spot. There is a sweet spot. I have this with a former student of mine who I've, you know, mentored. Now we're trying to write a book together. So she's a, you know, close friend of mine. And she's just, I call her, what do I call her? A pit bull squirrel, you know, I explain it this way. You know, she's a pit bull because once she grabs onto something, she's going to see it through. But then she's like a squirrel because her attention goes to something else, you know? And so she has a conceptualization of time that's way different than mine. It's like doing 1,000 things. And I'm like, no, because there is scientific evidence. There's been studies done on the importance of downtime, the importance of doing nothing.
Yeah,
you know,
big time.
There's an important, but there is. I mean, there. So it's basically getting a sweet spot, you know. I try to get the sweet spot in almost anything I try to do. You know, let's say if it's a course and stuff like that. Hey, yeah, I could give them so much material it would choke a horse, or I could give them hardly any material, and then so it's just too much for them or too little. So no, you have to find that sweet spot. And this is the same, you know, of how much material do you give them so they master the material and not cover everything.
Right. So they stay focused.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but it's with time also. And I think with this, you know, I think this is the best case scenario. The whole COVID-19 has been a reboot for people's conceptualization of and priorities concerning time. I hope so. Yeah. But it's but agency and structure. It's basically your agency, your own self will, and the structure of the context that you're in. Mm-hmm. You know, because I'm just so happy that I'm living in Austria, because I mean they pretty much closed down pretty quickly, and now they're up again.
Yeah,
you know, and everybody was like, okay, fine, and really it was like a ghost town here.
Yeah.
Ghost town. And everybody's like, yeah, okay, let's do it. No, that says a lot about the culture too. I mean, that's the thing that, I mean, I had a problem with, you know, living in the United States. It was, I mean, I never regret growing up there because, as I tell people, you know, as I tell my students who are looking for jobs and stuff like that, I said, I know this is the right thing for me. You know, I've done so many other jobs in my life that I know being a lecturer is the right thing, you know, because I've done other things and this is not, you know, this is not the worst gig I've ever had. But the thing is that people, I mean, the cultural thing, you know, that the problem I had with the United States was it was just too individual to its detriment. You know, again, and here sometimes, I guess in Austria, it's too group oriented. Yep. Then again, in this context, it worked out well for us. You know, we're not going to feel the hit as much as other countries.
Yeah, well, I think the countries are starting to come out of it now, I think. But I don't know if they'll ever fully come out of it because they still have the virus. Now, I just heard the other day that the virus was getting weaker. The scientists have determined that the actual virus is diminishing and that it could actually go away without a vaccine. Did you hear that?
Yeah. If you change habits, it will die out because it needs a host.
Yeah,
it needs a host.
It's getting weaker and going away. So anyway, I hope that's true too. I just think it'd be more human if we were more human.
Well, that's deep. Let me write that down.
That's the Holy Grail.
That's a quote for the ages.
Use that in your next lecture.
That's the podcast title. Would be more human. If we
could be more human. Get rid of the rest of it.
Another element of time I wanted to address, I've been scribbling down notes as we've been going along. We were talking about behavior, and you were talking about separating the person from the behavior. And Scary was then talking about the weird email that he'd received. And everyone's going to want to know what this weird email is. So if you want to know what the weird email is, please write in the comments. And if we get 1 million comments and 1 million likes, then we'll tell you what the email was. Okay, we need the likes to get the email.
If I get 1 million likes, then you're going to buy a T-shirt.
Yep, okay, we'll do that. And
what
I wanted to get was one of the important pieces that I've taken from the years and years of working with Scary is the element that Scary said that his first instinct was to go back at this person, pre-programmed to do that. But he didn't because he has that physical, I don't know if you have a physical awareness of your thoughts, but he had that awareness of his thoughts. So he knew what was going on. Would you say within communication, awareness of what you're saying and what's coming back at you is another key element? So you've got listening, is awareness of what's going on. Because a really cool tool that Scary gives to everybody, and I'm assuming he did that for you when you went to see the presentation, is to give a tool for everybody to be aware of what they're saying and what they're hearing, which is the 7-day, 7-night challenge.
Yeah.
Yeah. So for 7 days, 7 nights, so if you haven't heard it, 7 days, 7 nights, you don't say one negative word about another human being. And for 7 days, 7 nights, you don't call anybody a name other than their own. So you're then actually aware of what you're saying. You can't automatically say anything back. That's another way of giving you time, isn't it? Time to reevaluate who you are, what you're doing, and what your behavior is.
It's pushing. It's basically pushing you in a different area where most people haven't inhabited. Meaning being more reflective or reflexive, if you want to be sociological about it. That as you said, the time element. It pushes you in an area. It's like, okay, fine. I have to watch myself. And I've tried to do it, and I failed every time. But it's a good. Even if you're not successful, the process is actually the goal here.
Learning.
Doing. I mean, attempting it is, you know, having this process, and it's learned behavior. Again, it's like training. If you keep at it, you'll get better at it, you know? And I just think, I just reflect upon it myself. I'm like, oh my gosh. I'm like, oh God, half of my vocabulary is gone now, you know?
Yeah, well,
but when getting back,
I've been mourning the fact that half of my vocabulary has been gone for 20 years.
And you should hear what other half is left. So I dread to think what the other half was. Yeah.
This half was not all that good. It's just horrible.
Gary, if I understand the question correctly, the whole listening, but right-sizing the message to the person, the context. This is why, this is like the context that you're in. You have, and you have to read the room well. And that's, I tell the students that too. In the presentation course too, I basically tell them, stop broadcasting and start communicating. Have a conversation with these people. Stop just, because this is not actually the most efficient way of informing people. This is more of an event that they'll remember.
Yeah.
Because all their five senses are being present in this, and it's not an email or something like that. So you have to come into conversation. Again, it's, this is one of the core beliefs. Personally and professionally is, bringing people into, relationship. Relationship is key. And that's why, you need to take the context into consideration.
What's happening now on a lot of these social media platforms is that the broadcasts are getting shorter and shorter.
Yeah, the attention span of people. I mean, we've known that from Sesame Street.
Can you imagine that? On TikTok, it's 15 seconds or 10 seconds, and they broadcast it, and it's in your face, and it's done. And then you get the next little snippet, and the next little snippet from another person, and the next little. And you're sitting here like my brain is being inundated by 10-second pieces of information that are completely useless. And I'm going, wow. And this is what people are used to creating.
Yeah. And this is what they're growing up with.
Yeah.
So then
they're this learned behavior.
Yeah.
Again. Yeah. Again, it's a misuse of the technology.
Well, and how are they ever going to know how to really, truly sit down and communicate with each other and work through problems? Problem solve. How are they going to ever know how to do that if we raise generations of people that see 10 and 15 second pieces of broadcast information for the pure gratification of that moment? I don't understand how they're ever going to know how to communicate. I just don't know.
Well, I think you're going to have a minority that are going to be reflexive, meaning they're going to think about this and then act upon it. They're going to say, this is unhealthy behavior. I need to, fast from this. Or, and I know people who do that. They take time away from social media. Yep. My son does this. My oldest son, Patrick, does this. He fasts from social media, which is, it's a good, anything is, that's good. I mean, obviously, too little or too much of anything is bad.
Yeah.
Everything so finding the sweet spot.
Everything in moderation, including moderation.
Yeah. That's right. Oh, another quote. Yeah, let me write that down.
Write that one down. That's a good one. Everything in moderation, including moderation.
Moderation.
Because every now and then you have to go to excess.
Yes, that's right. Just to know what moderation is.
If you don't go to excess, then you'll never know what it's like to recover from a true hangover. Or be totally silent. Check that one out.
Yay. Well, during the hangover? I usually am. Besides my own groaning.
I can't afford a hangover today because they last for like 4 or 5 days now.
Exactly.
The older I get, the harder it is on my body. And it's like, oh my goodness, I'm not 20 anymore.
It's 2 days with me. So I guess with you, it'd be 4. Okay, great. Yeah. I know my future.
So you just said, Scary, totally silent. And it's a word that I'd written down on my piece of paper right at the very beginning of the pod. I just wrote some single words down around about communication. And silence is one that I've seen to be extraordinarily powerful
it's huge.
The silence, the amount of communication that Scary is able to put out without saying a single word, and the amount of communication he then gets back from the audience, who again are not saying a single word. It's extraordinary to watch that go down. You know, the facial expressions, the body movements, you can feel the energy change just in moments of silence. And I think,
well, that's the universal language.
Mm.
That's why he's successful in different countries, because this is a universal language that they're picking up. Mm. You know,
and that's too.
Yeah. But I mean, but silence is, I mean, there's been studies on that too. When going into negotiating, negotiating certain, you know, like a contract or stuff like that, and just the use of silence and getting more money. Or yep. That's why, I mean, I used to teach a lot in Finland, and Finland is stereotypical, known for being a very silent country. You know, the typical Finn is very quiet, which I found, I had absolutely zero problem with that. I don't need to fill the air with, you know, ephemeral verbiage, you know. There's a lot of strength in silence, because then you're giving space to be reflective. You know, and that's important. That's what you need to be human.
Let's try it. Perfect. That was good.
I was just seeing how long.
Good. No, now all the listeners went, oh, what happened to my speaker?
It's like, no, is it over?
Everybody that's used to watching TikTok and Twitter and all those other ones, they just went into like serious withdrawal. They're going to need to see a counselor.
Particularly if I edit that video clip of us everything just suddenly going.
Yeah.
No, but we had
everybody to freeze.
Certain expressions like.
Yeah.
Yeah. They must have technical in problems. Rant. Definitely, they have technical problems in their show.
They really should get a better modem.
Yeah. It's crazy. Life is crazy.
Oh,
okay.
Did I mute myself in the middle of a word?
Yeah. Yes, you did.
Was it a word that followed that weird?
Life is really. Did you like that? Wasn't that pretty cool?
I can read
it. Wasn't that really? Yes, I love the mute button. I don't know if you know that, but it is so powerful. And for those of you that have been picked on and bullied on social media, and you're sitting there depressed and upset and angry and frustrated and hurt and sad, man, just block them and delete them. That's what I always tell kids. I say, get rid of that person off of your social media. Don't go back there. Don't be subject to the same old routine over and over and over. You don't need to be liked by that person. They're not going to. They're going to continue to beat you up on the social media. Then ban and block them. That's what I tell them.
I think, I mean, I tell my kids this. I mean, it's like if they're in relationships and stuff like that, and, you know, and everybody's like posting this stuff on, you know, Facebook or Instagram, whatever. I said, you need to leave a certain space for personal life. And that needs to be off of the net.
Yeah.
You need that. Or, absolutely. I mean, or you go into this whole, social theory of, you know, Foucault and this panopticon that we're all looking.
Yeah.
You know,
well, that's happened to me during COVID-19. It's happened.
What?
Well, that I'm constantly chasing the next message. Mm-hmm. On my phone. I don't know if that's happened to you, but I'm up till 2:30 in the morning during COVID-19 because I'm not doing anything. You know, I'm watching TV till midnight. I'm looking at films. You know, and you get into the same pattern. And then I'm up, and then I'm going, okay, what did they say? How did they respond? And I'm monitoring it, and I'm chasing them, and I don't fall asleep till 2:30, 3 o'clock. And then when I fall asleep, I'm still thinking about what they just said on the social media. I'm going, well, yeah. That's almost sick. I'm almost sick from it. I'm losing sleep. Think about it. That's I wonder how many people are like that because of this whole thing. I mean, you know, it's really, really harmful.
Yeah, for your own mental health,
it's horrible.
You need to leave some space for stuff that's offline. You need to leave some space. And I think that goes with the whole theme of this entire podcast of the silence and listening and space and, you know, making healthy choices we're not saying, okay, you got to get rid of all social media.
No.
We're saying you just have to use it wisely for your own, you know, psychological, you know, welfare.
Well, if you don't learn to use it wisely, it's going to use you.
Oh yeah, definitely.
It'll eat you up. It'll chew you up, and it'll consume every waking moment of your life. You will have the biggest ulcer by the time you're 30 if you're in your 20s. No, I'm serious. People will get so bent out of shape because they don't know what to do about this, and it's just very, very. I'm with you. I don't think it's a social media as the problem. I think humans are trying to figure out how to communicate within that world, and how are we going to come out on the other side of this is yet to be determined. And that's the difficult part. That's why I was really excited about having you on, because you are dealing with people in the communication world, and you teach communication. You teach it at a university in Austria. And I think it's important to know from your vantage point what's going on in the world with people, because you see it. You feel
it. Yeah, I mean, yeah. And just on a pragmatic level, just having things, putting things online. I mean, I had to make a decision. They closed down the universities, you know, one day they closed it down. So I was like, oh, I have to, you know, I have classes to, and I had to flip them over into an online forum. And it just became a huge bottleneck, because the most efficient way of communicating, especially for what I do, it's not a whole bunch of exams. It's a lot of, you know, assignments, but it's basically, you know, performance. They have to either present or run a discussion or pitch something. And the most efficient way is face to face. And the feedback that I give, the most efficient is face to face. So I couldn't do that, or, you know, it just slowed down things and gave like at least three times as much work, because I have to write them back now. And I remember the first week of having these online classes, I spent the majority of my day just answering emails. And then you're just finished after that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we're coming to the end of this interview and this time with you. And I'm really grateful that you've taken the time.
I appreciate it.
Yeah, it's just really cool. And what I wanted to ask you is, what do you think we've learned from this episode? What do you think we could say that we've actually learned as the three of us here have put this forward, that we could actually, what would you want to say that we've learned? Because now you're a professional educator. Well, I want to know, what do you think we could all learn from this today and sum it up that way?
Well, I think Gary really, you know, hit upon it. I mean, it's the whole time element. I mean, and you know, from the whole context of, I mean, COVID-19, having that being thrust upon us, from what you teach and what you, I mean, it gives us an insight that we can slow down or at least, you know, gain more time when interacting with people.
That's the key valuable. Right now, isn't it?
It's just valuable.
I think we need to learn how to slow down.
Yeah.
Slow down, even though we're not moving. Think about it. You know, no, seriously, we're not. The whole world has been kind of in its own little prison. And that's just in its own little space. And now here we are talking about slowing down, and it's really what's going on inside of our minds and what we're doing with the information that we're getting off these little tubes, you know, these little screens every day. And we need to slow that down a bit.
Yeah, but we need the tools. We need the tools to do that. We need the tools to filter this inundation. And I remember getting a cell phone. I was the last one in the family to get a cell phone because I was like, I don't want to be reachable all the time. That was my attitude. You know, that was my freedom. I don't want to be reachable.
And now it's the opposite.
Yeah, I was going to say.
And now it's the opposite because I came around. I came around and I thought, okay, fine. I have to reframe this. I have to reframe this because this is not healthy. And I reframed it. Like, this is a tool that I can reach out to my kids and continue my relationship.
Yep. That was cool. You know? Well, I can't thank you enough for coming on and spending an hour with us. And
I appreciate the invitation.
I hope when all of this COVID gets better, we can come back to your university and actually visit you in person again. And maybe convince your university that what we teach is important, and come and share it with more of your university students. That would be really cool. I just would really think that would be exciting. I'd love to do that again.
I think that is the one lesson that we've learned from COVID, that human contact is highly important, and the quality of it is even more important.
Well, I need a Michael hug anyway.
I think I need another tattoo.
That sounds weird, but
I'm sure Gary will edit that out.
Well, time has flown. I think we definitely hit the sweet spot on the podcast. And if technology didn't exist, we wouldn't be sitting here talking to each other. It's been a pleasure to meet you and see you. And I can't wait to come to Austria and see your beautiful city and the beautiful country again and spend some time.
Please.
There.
Yes, we're open for business.
Looking forward to it. Thanks again.
Thank
Michael.
You, gentlemen.
Thanks,
Thank
Mike.
You. Right. Cheers.
Thank you for listening to the Scary Guy Podcast. This is a Vision Heart production.